We're going to get this panel started. So we're going to start with the first question or set of questions, and each of our panelists will introduce themselves, talk a little bit about their time here at Vassar, and how activism was a part of that experience. So, Okay, question number one for the panel. Can you briefly characterize your time at Vassar? What issues did you and your peers encounter? Along with that, are there any specific instances of racial bias that you remember? And we'll start with Maybelle.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Maybelle Taylor Bennett, and I'm class of 1970. My time here at Vassar was one filled with self-discovery. I got here in part because my high school counselor, Jean Wheeler, I'll never forget her, told me and my mother that if I wanted to waste my mother's money, I could apply to Vassar College. And my mother was real clear. I think she might have gone to the same mother school as Dr. McClary, Dr. Hamburg's mother. She said, this is my money, and you will go to Vassar College. So it was almost like a dare. The assumption out of my high school, which had not so much earlier been integrated, this was Western High School in Baltimore City, was that I probably would not measure up. So when I got here, when I applied, I was accepted. And when I got here, one of the biggest things I wanted to prove was that I was made of the kind of stuff that could cut the mustard at Vassar. When it came to activism, I got here in 1966, and I think there were 6 African Americans on campus and 12 that came in with my class. We started, I believe it was 68 or 67, the Students Afro-American Society, and I believe we were riding a crest of what was happening also in the rest of the country. And we decided to come together to talk about what kind of life we were having on Vassar's campus and what we would like to see differently. Lynn Carter was our first president of the SAS. And I don't know where she is now, but I think someone said she's in Hawaii. But the issues that we were confronting were, A, there weren't enough of us. B, we needed to have that part of social infrastructure that made us feel more comfortable on campus. Does this sound familiar? C, we wanted to make sure that Black studies is what we called it then, subsequently called Africana studies, was deemed academically important enough to stand on its own here, the study of who we are and what our culture was, or is worthy of academic rigor. And then, as we began to develop our set of non-negotiable demands, looking for more financial aid for students, looking for a different kind of recruitment for students, not just in the private schools, but in public schools around the country, looking for tenure track faculty, because we had, I think, only one at the time, looking for a place to be supportive of one another. We asked for segregated, although we didn't call it that, facilities for Black people. We wanted a dormitory for Black folks, so we didn't have to explain ourselves to the white students who wanted to touch our hair or wanted to ask questions about our culture and our background. So we had all of these demands. We had a demand for an urban center in downtown Poughkeepsie, because we were making inroads into the community in downtown Poughkeepsie. I think Poughkeepsie at that time was 25% Black. And we were going to some of the nightclubs downtown. Some of us worked with the Mid-Hudson Herald, which is an African-American newspaper. Some of us worked with model cities in downtown Poughkeepsie. Some of us worked with children at the time in Poughkeepsie schools. And so we wanted to make sure that the demand for academic rigor expanded into the Black community in Poughkeepsie. And when we were promised these things in the spring of 1969, by the time we came back in September, we felt as though the school was reneging on that promise. At that time, Nell Urich was the dean of faculty, and it felt as though she and the rest of the administration were not going to keep their word. And so out of a feeling of betrayal, we took over the building, and you probably know the rest of the story. I won't go on. I've been given the high sign. We might double back to that issue later on.
Okay, Richard.
Good afternoon. My name is Richard Roberts. I'm from the legendary class of 1974. We were the first class of freshman men admitted at Vassar. I grew up in New York City. I went to the High School of Music and Art. We had 587 graduating seniors and one college counselor. My one contact with my college counselor, it consisted of her coming to me and saying, "By the way, did you ever think you might want to go to Yale?" I said, "Never thought about it." She said, "Okay." That was the end of that. Turned out later on that she had some information about a scholarship that would have fit me perfectly, but she had 586 other students to talk to. So I was engaged in a rather random selection process, but it was focused upon New York schools, where I had, I think, a New York Regents scholarship that I could apply if I could go to a New York school. My intention was to go to Cornell. I went to Cornell, visited over a weekend, stayed with the Black men who had taken over the administration building the year before, was very encouraged about it. I enjoyed the experience, so I applied and I got in. When I got the admissions letter, it came also with another letter later on, signed by Carson Carr, who was then the Dean of Admissions and Financial Aid, which essentially said, "We'd love to have you, but we're not giving you any money." That was the end of that story. I couldn't afford it. But I also got into Vassar. Vassar, on the other hand, said, "We'd love to have you, and we'll give you some financial aid." That is why I went to Vassar. I really had no intention of being a trailblazer and co-educational adventure, but it turns out it worked out okay. When I got here, Vassar was a 1,600 student population. We had 63 African-American women and 7 African-American men. For those math majors, that's a 9-to-1 ratio. Because of the efforts of many, like Maybelle and others who are here, LaFleur and Pat and some others, who had taken over the administration building and pressed for demands for African-American housing, Kendrick House, which is right across the street, was the African-American Cultural Center and residence. I lived there for 4 years. It was a place where, in my freshman year, there were 2 Black men and 36 Black women. Mathematicians can tell you that's a 1-to-18 ratio. So what was my life like at Vassar? I won't go into that. I can tell you that it was a time and a place of significant intellectual and political growth for me. I can tell you that that occurred in part because of Dr. Milford Fierce, the first director of Black Studies. Whenever you took his course, he told you very plainly, "You have to be serious," and he meant it. He was no slouch. When you did research for him and turned in a paper, if you thought you could just slide by and turn in something substandard, he'd tell you it would not work. You'd have to rework it. We never tried that again, and he held us to very high standards. He also was the house fellow in Kendrick, and he was available to us when we had issues that we had to deal with respect to social interactions, political things, and so on. It was also a time of intellectual growth because of some people that I was fortunate enough to be in school with. One of them is seated right here in the middle row. His name is Dr. Harold Wheeler. He is a physician who came in the year after me. He and another student named Larry Welton and some others were engaged in a study session, a Paul Robeson study group, where we were attempting to elevate our own consciousness about the political situation domestically and internationally. And I'd ask Harold, I won't use your nickname back then, to raise your hand. This is one of my compatriots with whom I experienced a great deal of intellectual and political growth during that time. Part of your question was whether we had any kind of incidents on campus. My first year as a freshman, I was in the library right across the way there, doing what, frankly, students are supposed to do. That is learn, research, go into the bookshelves, read. I was doing that. As I was crossing around the front of the front desk, there was a person at the front desk. I don't know to this day whether the person was a student on a work-study job or a staff member, but the student looked at me somewhat quizzically and said, can I see your ID? Do you have a Vassar ID? I stopped and wondered and looked around at the other people who were in the library and didn't see her asking anybody else for their ID. I challenged her for asking me something like that, and she said, well, I'm going to call security on you. Yeah. That happened, but I made a decision at that point. I don't deserve to have to go through this. I made a decision that I also regretted. I said, I'm not going to stand around and wait to be harassed. So I packed up my books and I left. I now regret that because it was a loss of a teaching moment to whoever that person was at the front desk who did not challenge any of the other students who were in that library doing what they were supposed to do, reading, working, walking around. And perhaps that person at the front desk would do that yet with another black man in 1970 who was an oddity to her point of view. So that was one incident that I had. One other experience that I had where I regretted something I had not done. My freshman year, I was taking a computer science course in Fortran, taught by not a full-time faculty member, but someone who was a computer programmer at IBM on the local campus. All of the midterm tests and midterm quizzes and midterm projects, I got straight A's on. The end of the semester, we were told to think up our own independent project. I came from a New York City public high school. We got examinations. We did the examinations and turned them in. It was yes or no questions or multiple part questions, and we were told what to answer, and I answered them, and graduated pretty well. She told me and the rest of the class, do an independent project and turn it in. I had no clue about what that was. I had to think up on my own how to do an independent project. I sat back, everybody else was doing theirs. I didn't know how to do it. I never did go and say, I need some help. I was 17 years old. I didn't know what I was doing. I'd never navigated college. And I was too immature to go ask for help. So I didn't turn one in. I got an F. I failed that class. But that teacher never reached out to me either. I suspect that that teacher may have thought, well, who is this insolent black man not turning in the program or the proposal? So she failed me. Never reached out to me, never asked, I haven't gotten anything. Is there anything I can help you with? Is there any problem here? What can I do for you? Just failed me and never contacted me. I regret now not having had the maturity to go to her and ask for help. But I'm also I'm disappointed that she didn't come to me and see what's going on, because otherwise I'd been getting A's throughout that course. Mm-hmm. I realized it a little bit too late, but I took the course again the next year and got a straight A, which I should have gotten before. So those are some of the experiences I had at Vassar, and it turned out to be okay in the end because I learned a lot. I got a lot of friends. I had very strong role models from a lot of black women who did a lot of strong things and who are doing a lot of special things today.
Thank you, Richard. Karen?
Thank you, Jasmine. Okay. I'm Karen Clopton, and I graduated in 1980. I'm going to do a little something different. Jasmine asked, were there any incidents or what were the issues, that sort of thing. So I did some studying in the library. And we do have this documentary chronology. And so I went through the entire my four years here, and called out a few little highlights. And I'm just going to read them out in that way that I used to do in college when I was doing performance art. That's what we called spoken word. We dance, and have a drummer, and read poetry, which was really lines of interesting words put together. And you know how they drop the mic now, where we would throw all the papers all over the, you know, place. And that was fun. I won't be doing that part of it. Okay. So, because if I bend down, I might not get up. All right. So, okay. The Student Faculty Race Relations Committee in February of 77 insisted that the Intercultural Center be in the Lathrop basement. Lathrop did not want this in the Lathrop basement. They were overridden finally, and it was put in the Lathrop basement. This was funny to me because today one of the students described the Alana Center as that dark place over there. You know, like, oh, it used to be in the basement. Okay, and before that, didn't really have a big solid home. February 21st, 1977, this is my freshman year. Freshman year, two white students dressed up as Ku Klux Klan members in Ku Klux Klan regalia, and they harassed their black friend. Natalie Marshall, 51, was on the court at that time, and the college court found, quote, no particular evidence of racist intent, unquote. Hmm. 300 students protested both the incident and the result. February 1977. Black student, young black man, class of 1978, was arrested in New York City on a subway platform by a white police officer, hauled off to the pokey, and Alan Simpson was the president of Vassar College, and he stood up and he said, we will do everything we can to make sure none of our students suffer these kinds of indignities. And he hired legal counsel and made sure that the charges were dismissed. 1978, April 4th, 10th anniversary of Martin Luther King's assassination, we marched in Poughkeepsie. November 78, the Students Afro-American Society protested the failure to renew the chair of the Africana Studies program's contract, and that was Professor Barbara Paul Emile. Mm-hmm. February 78, SAS invited and met with and had lunch with who is now representative, congressional representative, but then an activist, John Lewis, during our cultural weekend. 1978, in November, Jim Jones led a mass suicide, People's Temple, 900 Americans killed in Guyana, most of them African Americans. Vassar started a multidisciplinary course on cult. The Student Afro-American Society had another lecture in 79, The Black Roots of King Tut, at the Urban Center. April 1979, the White Angels, who were our dorm desk attendants and were called the White Angels, and the black cleaning ladies were called the Green Ladies. That's what they were called when I was a freshman, and in April 1979, we asked that the White Angels no longer be called the White Angels. October 1978, 50 students barricaded the Board of Trustees in at Main Building during a meeting. demanding divestment from South African investments. December 1978, women's studies was offered for the first time here at Vassar College, the Women's College. February 1978, our slogan for ongoing protests, take a stand, Vassar College, don't support this racist land. We had ongoing committees. We had the Student Defense Committee, how the administration, the Board of Trustees, and student government frustrated the South African issue. We had pickets daily starting in April of 79 until the end of the school year, condemning apartheid in South Africa. We had women's safety patrols, because we were concerned about women's safety on campus, so we had self-defense courses, and we had campus patrol walking women home after attacks on women at Skinner. There were two attacks on women at Skinner. And this, everybody should know. In 1979, a Freedom of Information Act request revealed over 332 FBI documents on surveillance of students at Vassar College from 1939 to 1975, including when the Dean of Students requested 1,700 pamphlets of your rights if arrested for student use. They were watching. And Dr. Christmas mentioned this earlier today about her FBI file. Africana Studies, we fought for Africana Studies, and just before I graduated, in April of 1980, then President Virginia Smith invited William F. Buckley to speak at our commencement. Well, this wasn't going to happen. She called me into the office to say, I don't like threats. I said, I'm not threatening you. I'm just letting you know that William F. Buckley will not be speaking at my graduation. So my parents were concerned, is she going to graduate? We started petitions, over 300 seniors out of the 506 in my class of 1980 signed a petition requesting Virginia Smith to disinvite William F. Buckley. We organized the black faculty, the current black faculty, as well as the emeritus black faculty to write letters, and we got Marion Secundi and others involved. And the Africana Studies, Professor Norman Hodges was very engaged in this, and I was writing a weekly column in the Miscellany News called In Defense of Change. I reprinted the demands from 1969, as well as our current demands and concerns, and did that on an ongoing basis. And on May 19th, 1980, William F. Buckley withdrew from speaking at commencement. We did not have a commencement speaker, and he called us ferociously illiterate and fearfully malinstructed.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Karen. That was extremely informative. Cleon, thank you.
Yes. Okay, I'm a member of the class of 1990, and I had come to Vassar from a community college in Queens, in New York City. I'm from New York, so I didn't have the pleasure of being here for the full four years. So, and I think an important thing before I arrived is I did something called Explore and Transfer. I don't even know if they still have the program, but I think I did the third year that it existed, so the summer of 1987. And, you know, now that I reflect back, it was a program that I enjoyed it was designed really to give students who were at a community college the ability to sort of understand what it was like to be at an institution like Vassar, to be away from home instead of at a commuter college. So, but you know, now that I think about it, it did much more than that, because it wasn't a program that was designed per se for Black students. It was just for kids who were probably in more so urban environments to really come and have that experience. So what it did, and I now that I think about it, is it gave me, I think, a point of reference. Because when I got here, I wasn't sort of thrown into the mix. Those of us who attended Vassar, I think we can admit that there's a definite culture at this school. So when I came, it sort of, I think, gave me a chance to sort of almost define the space differently than I think if I sort of was thrown right into the mix. And I think it was invaluable because it gave me a point of reference or something once, when I decided to attend Vassar once I graduated from and got my associate's degree and came, it sort of gave me, I think, an important point of reference where I could compare what the experience was like at this institution with people who came from different community colleges but similar background to where I was coming from, and then sort of compare that to the experience when I was here as a student at the college. And I think it sort of informed a lot of decisions I made, and sort of, you know, I think my experience would have been totally different if it didn't. And it, you know, I know earlier we were talking about a program that Paula mentioned, Transitions, I think it was called. And I think it was probably a similar thing. It sort of accomplished something that was similar to this program. And I think for students who, this institution was certainly built for students who a completely different experience than those of us who are now populating the campus. And those programs are important because, again, it made a huge difference for me. When I was here, Lathrop was the intercultural center, the Black student center, or whatever you want to call it. And on our list of demands, it's so funny because I keep hearing, we all had lists of demands, and probably the lists were not that much different. And probably the common theme with all of those lists were, we wanted to be respected as students who were here for a purpose, just like anyone else, and we wanted an institution that was going to respect the fact that, not that we were different, but maybe we came from a different experience than some of the other students who were here, and we wanted it to be a more welcoming place. And obviously, one of the huge incidents that happened while I was on campus was the takeover, 1990 takeover of our main building, that was prompted by an incident that happened when, you had William Buckley, we had Senator Moynihan, supposedly they're on opposite ends of the political spectrum. But, racism, I think, has a way of, So he was invited to the campus to get the Eleanor Roosevelt Distinguished Chair. So it was, an honor that was being bestowed on him. And at the time, so happens that there was a group of students who were trying to pull together, and this was very different at the time, they were trying to pull together sort of a coalition of students who were looking at common concerns that students had, not Black students, not Jewish students, but, issues that as students that we should be concerned with. And I was kind of skeptical because it wasn't something at the time. I was the president of the Black Student Union. And, you know, so I was a little skeptical. I wasn't sure, you know, what this would really mean, or would it be potentially a vehicle that would make sense for me to participate in some of the things that they were trying to do. And once they heard Moynihan was coming on campus, they started, you know, passing out information about his background, about the Moynihan report, and you know, just educating people about some of his policies and the impact that he had, or his policies had. And so you sort of had a vehicle in place at that time that once he came on campus, and, you know, I'm sure we can discuss it. I can have an opportunity to talk about what happened. It was February 14th when we ended up taking over the building. But essentially, he insulted a member of our campus community who happened to be the wife of one of our professors. And I was actually there when he made the remarks, and she was basically debating some of the points that he made during his speech in the chapel. I think that the key thing he said was he was talking about the breakup of the Soviet Union, and he referred to the U.S. as a model of ethnic cooperation. And, you know, we challenged him on that, and so did this woman, and things got a little heated, and he made remarks. He basically said to her, she is from Jamaica, and he said, you know, lady, if you don't like it here, you can pack your bags and go back to where you came from.
Nice.
And clearly that was not acceptable.
Clearly?
And, you know, and what was hurtful, even more than that hurtful comment, was the unwillingness of the leaders at this institution to respond to that and to protect us, because that was an attack not just on her but on all of us. And, you know, and it's hurtful that 25 years later, and this is my 25th year reunion, that we're still dealing with similar issues. And, you know, at my time it was, you know, Ricky mentioned the number of students there. It hadn't changed that much. There weren't that many more students in 1990. It was a similar number, probably even fewer Black men. I think one of the classes that I was part of, we had no incoming freshmen, I believe, and one Black male transfer student. So I think it was either 92, one of those years. It was in the early 90s. So that was an issue. So when you think about the fact that you had the total number of Black men on campus, you can count on both hands, but yet we were being carded multiple times and had people wherever we went asking for ID, and we had not only campus police doing that, but we had campus patrol of these students who, they were like a little vigilante group half of the time. And, you know, so that was sort of, you know, puts in some context to, you know, my experience at this school, and I'm looking forward to discussing these issues more.
Thank you. Cleaver?
Hi, I'm Kleaver Cruz from the class of 2011. I just want to start by saying thank you. I know that I'm here because of you and the people that you worked with and were here at the time, and that I stand on your shoulders, and that I was able to be a part of this community because of the work that you all did. So I just want to say thank you. I'm humbled to be here. I think the way to describe my experience at Vassar is mixed. I was a better chance student in high school, and I went to a really great public school in Western Massachusetts, a very similar setting, like mostly white liberal students in a campus that is about creating the next generation and figuring out how are we gonna change the world. And so when I came to Vassar, I walked through the gates when I was a junior in high school, and I knew that this is where I wanted to be. I don't know how to explain it. It was a feeling that this is where I was supposed to be. And I was committed. And when I got admitted, it was like, I told y'all, this is. And so when I got here, I really loved it. I loved being here. I got to be a part of Focus Weekend in my senior year of high school. And that really got me connected to some of the people that have now been my best friends in the world. And so getting here at the beginning, wasn't a big acclimation. Like, I was really good in school, so academics wasn't that hard. Socially, I had learned how to be in a space like this. I think it was some of my friends who didn't have that experience and seeing how they were transitioning or not transitioning into this space that really got me thinking about what is happening here. What is different about my experience that is giving them such a hard time? And then it sort of became this running joke where I felt like every spring there was something crazy happening. Some kind of incident was occurring that we had to organize ourselves around. But I want to backtrack a little bit. Was when I was applying to schools, one of the major factors, of course, was financial aid. And Vassar actually wasn't the school that gave me the most financial aid. But I remember when I came to visit the school, there was a tight-knit community of students of color at the Alumnae Center, and I wanted to be a part of that. I saw them loving each other and like figuring out how are we going to be together in this space, and I just wanted to be a part of that. And so I came to Vassar. And I think it was a wave. The first year I really loved it, and then by the time my second year, my sophomore year ended, I just didn't want to be here anymore. I couldn't stand it. I was over being a part of the group of people that were constantly being attacked or experiencing negativity, and then we also had to be the ones to organize and educate people. And remembering a friend of mine who said that she had called her mom, and her mom told her, your job is to be educated. Like, you went to school to get a degree. Everything else is extra. And thinking about, like, that's complicated, right? Like, that's not necessarily the truth, because we have to survive and thrive to be here. And so figuring out, what is that gonna take for us to take care of ourselves? And to figure out when do we choose to educate or to engage in these conversations. Because it was all the time. It was in classes, like my friend Bonnie is in the audience, and we took almost all sociology classes together. And I remember us looking at each other just like crazed looks of, I can't believe these things are being said in classes. And these experiences of theory to most and reality to us, right? To sit in a class where pages are being turned and people are talking about urban blight and all these different things as if it's not real. And for me, you're talking about my neighborhood, you're talking about my aunt, these people that I live and go back to at each vacation or anytime I go back home, and sort of navigating what is that, right? That for so many people here, there's theory and not reality. And that I was privileged enough to go back to the Bronx and understand that what I'm experiencing is privilege. And so how do I bring home to this space? Because we deserve to be here too. And constantly reminding myself that I don't have to prove myself to be here, that I worked hard to be here and that I deserve to be here and that everyone needs to understand that. And that I need to check that because I have a space and money is green and everyone's color is the same, right, when it comes to that. And to think about some of the incidents, the ones that stand out to me were there was an incident where in Jewett, one of the curtains or the shades or something, there was a string and it was tied into a noose. And that became like a whole thing and people argued about it's a Boy Scout knot and it's not that serious. And there was all these community meetings around that. And thinking about like the fact that that's a conversation is an issue, right? That we don't even have a sense or context of history that would even be an act occurred that didn't bother a lot of people. In my sophomore year when we had the mini courses, a group of students formed a class called the Language of Ladies, and it was formed by a student, a young white male, who had traveled to certain parts of the world, he and his friends, and they were going to offer a class to school people on how do you talk to people of these parts of the world. And the first class was called Orienting Yourself with Ladies of the Orient. And this person had went to Japan for a little bit of time, and he was going to lead this class on how do you talk to Japanese women. And so there was a lot of students organized around that. The ASU, other students of color organized, went to that class on the first day to let them know, like, this is not going to go down. And that led to a series of other actions. I'll stop there, but I want to say that one of the things that I think I got the most out of Vassar was to ask questions, to be clear on what you're asking, and to move away from, was that racist, or was that sort of the surface level questions, but to get deeper of like, why is this happening? How do we stop that from happening? What do we need to be a part of to create a shift or a change in this environment? So I feel like I got so much better asking questions and to go to the source. I feel like I'm in a space now when people tell me things, you could be like the expert on something and I still need to figure it out for myself to go there and see for myself, is this the truth? And I feel like that led me at Vassar all over the world. I got to travel to like 7 different countries when I was here and do all kinds of things that allowed me to be at the source of where things were occurring so that I can be clear on the questions that I'm asking. And I felt like particularly the Africana Studies program allowed me to be able to understand who I was in relation to the world and not just the US, and to be able to articulate what I was seeing when I was traveling to these different places. So I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful again for you all, really am.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, panelists, so much for your answers there. They were great and they were informative. They were also a little bit long. So as a result of that, I'm going to jump a little bit to organizational structure questions, because a lot of you talked about the kinds of organizational protest, if you want to call it that, that you did while you were here. And I wanted to get into questions about what that organization looked like. So if you could each talk about what the process of organization was for the protest work that you engaged in, the communication, the relationship with administrators, leadership, and also how you think that structure helped or hindered your success. So we'll start again with Maybelle.
Well, we were part of the Students Afro-American Society, which I think, again, was established in 67, if I'm not mistaken. But the interesting thing about our takeover of the building was, and I was vice president, Jo Brown Gray, I think she has another name, but anyway, Jo Brown at the time was the president. Interestingly enough, the organization of going in and taking over the building, and this was the common spaces in main building, did not take place with the leadership of SAS. Part of that was strategic, because the idea is if we got arrested or if we were thrown out of school, those of us who went in, the leadership still existed. So the people who actually organized that were sophomores, interestingly enough. And we had to make a decision. There were only 2 of us who were seniors who went in. And this was taking place at a time when Sheriff Quinlan in Dutchess County was running for office again. And so there was an urgency about what do we need to do. And he was instructed, I'm told, by Glenn Johnson at the time, with a phone call from Nelson Rockefeller, if I'm not mistaken, that you don't go on that campus unless and until you are invited. This is a private school. So we were trying to make sure that we had our leadership intact, and those who went in and organized what we were doing did what they did. Let me interject something else here, because one of the questions you asked was, is it necessary to be angry to be able to do some of the things that we did? And yeah, we were angry because we thought there was betrayal there. But the use of violence was never something that we really contemplated. There are all kinds of different ways of being violent. This was October of 69. Columbia's takeover was in 68, and they had a lot of damage to property and all of that. We were not interested in damaging property. We were not interested in hurting people. We knew we were under surveillance. There was no question about it. And later on, I found out that I have a record at the Defense Intelligence Agency or something, you know? But we were trying to get things done. We were trying to keep our eyes on the prize. So the vehicle we used, SAS, was appropriate for us. But let me say that the takeover itself was relatively military in certain ways. You know, we dressed in black, we took our positions on the lawn at about 3 in the morning. We advanced. We only knew what we needed to know to accomplish what we were supposed to do. My job was to take over the switchboard, all right, and not do it in a way that would anger or hurt the switchboard ladies. I had to get one of them to teach me how to use it. Mm-hmm. And she told me it took her 6 months, And I politely said, well, that's why I go here and you work here. So she taught me how to do it, and we thanked her for her assistance, and then let her
Come
go.
Come on, Maybelle. Maybelle learned how to do it in 10 minutes.
But I mean, we had to do our homework. You know, we couldn't block the delivery of mail because that's a federal offense, but we could rope off where the students actually went and actually accessed their mail. So there were levels of organization. There was the SAS, there was the organizing group that had to do a lot of homework and who had to develop strategy. There was the group that ended up meeting with the president and members of the board, which was separate from some of the organizers and separate from the leadership of SAS, so that we used different ways of acting and communicating our concerns so that we could be nimble and we couldn't be lopped off at the head. The other thing is that one of the other questions you asked had to do with allies. We did have some allies. We had white students who were on the circle in front of main building who were supportive. We also had very strong ties in the Poughkeepsie community. Dr. Sanders, who was a black physician from the city, came to us to help us if there were any issue at all about our getting sick or fearful or passing out or any of those kinds of things. They were there for us. So we had to be creative and nimble about how we went about doing things. And one of the things that I also wanted to say was, of the things I learned early because of this, was the value of commitment. What does commitment look like? I was putting 3 years of my education on the line in the event that I got thrown out of school. How much did I really care about what we were doing? You know, my mama drove up it without taking a stop for 5 hours from Baltimore City just to make sure that I was still enrolled. Ozzie Davis came up and addressed the Board of Trustees on our behalf, always defining himself as a parent of one of the students when everybody in that room knew he was a whole lot more than just a parent. You know, so there were levels of commitment at every level from the city of Poughkeepsie and the people we had made contact with, to our parents, to our students. There were 33, somewhere I read it was 33 out of the 59 there. I thought there were 38. But anyway, it was the majority of those of us who were enrolled, black Americans who were enrolled, who actually took over the building. I learned a lot about myself and my ability to make commitments, which has lasted for lo these 46 additional years. So I'm grateful for that, and I'll stop.
Thank you.
I was a beneficiary 1 year later coming here of the lessons that were told to us about the benefits of commitment and consensus and communication, because 4 years later when I graduated, we had a sense that the promises that had been made by the Board of Trustees and the administration had not really been followed through fully. Black students in the class of 1974 decided we had to take a stand about some of that. We decided to reaffirm our commitment to the interests of African American people and people of color, both on the campus and in the community and around the world, by making a decision. We had a wonderful dean of residence who was very strict but very strong, quite patient. Her name was Elizabeth Drouillet. Dean Drouillet, we called her the Drew, made sure that she called every single graduating senior when that senior had not paid her or his dues to rent a cap and gown. If you didn't pay your dues to rent that cap and gown, you were not marching, period. That is the message she gave you. Black students who decided we had to take a stand decided we weren't going to wear caps and gowns. We were going to wear African garb. We wore dashikis and abubas and galas. Dean Drouillet knew that we had not paid our dues. Interestingly, however, we did not get those calls from Dean Drouillet. I understood some other students did, who were not African American. They were told quite strictly, you pay your dues or you're not marching. We decided, though, that we wanted to reaffirm our commitment, as I said, to this community, to African Americans, to the progress that had been begun under the leadership of these students, but that there had been some falling back, and we were going to make sure that we had our voices heard about that. We prepared, all right, the commitment and communication. We gathered under the organization of the Students African American Society all of the graduating seniors. We took a poll. We told those folks, we want everybody to do this. Those who don't want to do it, no recriminations. But those who do, let's get together and make sure that when we show up at that graduation line right outside the back of that building, we're wearing our red, black, and green armbands and our African garb. We had a good number of people from the graduating class who did that. We also prepared a statement. I happened to find it in my papers that it was called something of a manifesto, but it was really our statement of principles. And we had some freshmen who were in the class of 77 who helped pass these things out at graduation to all the people who were in the audience. the students did not use any violence. We didn't scream. We didn't yell. We showed up. We got in line just like everybody else did, but we were not wearing caps and gowns. We took the money we were going to spend on caps and gowns and donated it to AfriCare. AfriCare was raising money to donate to the drought-ravaged regions of the Sahel and Western Africa. And we proudly put out a statement talking about that. And we did it under the aegis of the organization of the Students African American Society. We found that to be a useful way to organize it and to carry it out. It was done with great dignity. It's interesting that there were different ways different people decided to make different statements. We had at our graduation, running across the stage at the bottom of that slope, a streaker. Streaking was, I guess, in vogue at the time. Our streaker wore an American flag draped on his back and a Nixon mask and nothing else. There were probably a great deal of befuddled parents coming up to this graduation saying, what am I looking at? That's how we organized it, and that's how we carried out what we did at that time.
Thank you. Karen?
We did have allies for, really, for everything that we were up to, including the divestment movement was very integrated. There was the SAS, as well as Coalition for Social Responsibility, which was a multi-ethnic student initiative and organization. When the black students, we didn't take over the whole of Maine, but we did take over the second floor, mainly to keep the president occupied and at the fore of we wanted to remain at the fore of her concerns, and we did have alliances also with the LGBTQ community during my 4 years, and but that was not universal. So there wasn't a consensus in SAS to support the LGBT among us, as well as there were those who did. So our leadership was divided in dealing with those kinds of alliances and coalitions. But our organization as black students in SAS, and we also had social and cultural other organizations, including the gospel choir was strong. Judge Rickey mentioned the Paul Robeson study group. That carried on, certainly when I was a freshman. I was in the Paul Robeson study group because my first friends at Vassar were seniors, Lori Fitzpagato and Christine Ortique. And so they carried on the study group. I was in the Paul Robeson study group, and we carried that on. And so learning from our elders, learning from what went on before us, and making sure we continued to do the research. When I went through the pile and I said, this is what, you know, I found out, I had to do research really to find in the old myths, what were the demands in 1969, how did Alan Simpson address them, and then I had them reprinted in 1979. And so we continue to use campus news organizations to get the word out, as well as doing the outreach. I think it's great now that they have the Alana Center and a lot of different groups together, but yeah, moving beyond that to do campus-wide outreach, which we also did in the in dealing with the William F. Buckley debacle.
Thank you. Something that we had available to us that my fellow panelists didn't was we had AAAVC in 1990. So, you know, one thing I think you learn as a student here pretty quickly is the administration, I don't, whether it's purposeful or not, I'm sure some of it is intentional, is they recognize that, you know, for students, we're sort of transitory. We're sort of passing through. So when we would try to, you know, ask for change, you know, we would get a lot of talk, a lot of, yeah, you know, we're going to do this and we're going to get the intercultural center and whatever. I think the value of having AAAVC was that it provided us with some historical context. So we understood that the things that we were up against, that, you know, it wasn't the first time, that there was a history of and an attitude, a pervasive attitude that had existed here for quite some time. And I think as students who were faced with the challenges that we were faced, that was reassuring. So when I called, when we took over the building and I was a spokesperson, and, you know, it wasn't, you know, when the whole Moynihan incident happened, there definitely was not consensus among the black students, and even though I was the president of the BSU at the time, a lot of people did not agree with some of the actions that this other coalition of students were taking. And so my involvement was not as, you know, in my capacity of the president of that organization. And a lot of the black students and some of us were part of the BSU leadership. Yeah, it was clear that we were not representing the organization. And, you know, because there simply wasn't consensus. But, you know, the fact that I could call Paula Madison at 5 in the morning and wake her up and say that, you know, oh, Paula, you know, we're taking over our main building. And, you know, and I think the first question she asked was, oh, did you ask for amnesty? You know, you think, you know, a Vassar student, you would understand, you know, you have a vocabulary. So amnesty? No, we didn't ask for that. So being able to, and Paula was like, you know, don't say much, I'm going to be up there. And she was like up a few hours later on campus meeting with the president and, you know, and other things. But it was invaluable to be able to make that phone call. And I think my fellow panelists, you know, they didn't have that luxury. And, you know, we knew about the takeover in 69 and it, you know, it was legendary. And, you know, and I think what many of us appreciated when we were here was that, you know, everyone pays tuition, you know, some more than others to go to Vassar, but, you know, a lot of us realize that, you know, for us to be here, we pay a lot more than than money. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of us saw it as an obligation to honor the advocacy and activism that was demonstrated by brave students before us, that we had to uphold that legacy. And we had to do so when you see injustice, we felt it was an obligation to stand up. So when Moynihan did what he did, and the administration at the time failed to act, we knew that we had to protect ourselves. And we were really well organized. We understood the value that other members of that coalition brought when you had white students involved. They had parents who were attorneys and this, and so we enlisted parents, some of the students, for those of us who knew that we could get arrested if they decided to send the police in or what have you, you had students call their parents and basically say, hey, you may need to bail some of us out. You need to give us advice. And you know, a lot of us, we didn't have parents necessarily who were attorneys that we could call to do that. So there was some value to being a part of a coalition like that. And there was also an incident where you had the KKK leaflet in the surrounding community. And at one point, the Grand Wizard, or whatever they call their leader, or whatever, was arrested. And he was caught with guns driving through Poughkeepsie or something like that. And so we decided to demonstrate since they were on this recruitment drive. And we were so well organized because we had probably about 400 students participate in a march from campus through Poughkeepsie. And we had it in rows of four. We practiced before. We practiced civil disobedience. We had classes where people taught. We had professors who were involved who talked about it. And then we had white students on the outside because we felt the police would be less likely to beat us up if you had white students on the front. So everything was very thoughtful in terms of how we planned and organized. And then when we had to take over the main building, and we understood that one of the risks were that we could get kicked out of school, we could get arrested, particularly those who volunteered to actually go in the building. Now, I was the spokesperson, so I wasn't actually inside the building, per se. And I wasn't even there when these students were running across campus at like 4 a.m. to take them. We took over the switchboard. They fought us a little bit more. That seemed like a really cooperative person who was there.
Maybelle can be very persuasive when she wants to be.
Right, so they locked the door and they had like a cutout thing in the glass. So we had to find, they had to find the thinnest student, you know, and I think it was a white student who sort of jimmied his way through that hole somehow to open the door. And, you know, so it was, but before we even did it, we had all campus meetings. We tried to discuss, you know, what our concerns were. You know, we had this big meeting in the chapel. We went to President Ferguson's office a couple of days before and sort of Maybelle, and the way Karen does it, we sort of went to her and we said, you know, you have 72 hours to act. You know, we weren't threatening. It wasn't threatening, even though some students use some really colorful language. But, you know, we made our point. And the point that we wanted to make was that as students of this college, you are here to protect us and to stand up for us. So when they didn't do that, we gave them 72 hours. We organized in between that. And we had people with, we put out a press release. We didn't have social media at the time. So we, you know, we did conventional things. And then once Paula sent that news crew, and next thing you know, we have NBC and we have CNN on campus. And, you know, so it was, you know, we were able to get the word. After a while, it wasn't not just a Vassar story, but it was something that sort of, you know, was part of the dialogue in the country. And people were aware of what was happening. And again, to have those alums, and I think Laurie Fitzbogato worked in D.C. on Capitol Hill at the time. To have those connections was something I think that you guys probably did not have. And it was good to be able to call someone like Paula or call Laurie Fitzbogato. And it gave us an opportunity to sort of be heard in a way that was probably not possible in prior years. So.
Thinking about this, it's funny, I wrote down notes, and I feel like in a way my process or approach was Trojan horse, and figuring out where were the places I needed to be in to change it from within. So I remember like when I first got here, during the orientation, the diversity section was terrible. It wasn't, I didn't feel like there was actual dialogue occurring. It just felt like a check mark was passed. And so I joined the committee to specifically change that part and to figure out how do we actually create continuous conversation so that that day is a launch of a dialogue as opposed to something that was presented. I didn't have a very good student fellow experience, and so I became one to figure out how do I shift the experience that I was having in Maine. My sophomore year, I was invited with a group of students to be a part of something called Transitions at Vassar, which is a collective of faculty members, administrators, and students to figure out how do we address students of color, low-income students, and first generation, and the overlap of all that. And so we were tasked with figuring out what are initiatives that we can create. Honestly, it felt, thinking back to that, it felt more like maybe we could figure out something short-term, kind of quick to make it happen. And the students that I was a part of, the group I was a part of, with Professor Mampilli, we were thinking much longer term. And so we created the Transitions Program, which is now the pre-matriculation program for low-income and first-generation students. Because as I was saying before, I had a bunch of friends here that didn't have the experience I had, and that their transition was very rough. And I remember sitting in rooms where there were seniors saying that semester they were just beginning to feel comfortable at Vassar, and figuring out, like, I never want anyone at Vassar to feel that. That it took them almost the entirety of 4 years to feel comfortable in this space. And so we did all kinds of research. We interviewed our friends. We looked around the country at schools that both were comparable to ours and ones that weren't, to figure out how can we create a substantial proposal to this institution to really hold them accountable, right? Because if we're going to invite students of all colors and shades and experiences, then we need to also take care of them and love them in the way that the institution says that they're going to. And so our mission was to hold the institution accountable to that. And so originally we proposed a 6-week program that would have, it was very similar to the HEOP program in New York State, and that didn't happen. But eventually a version of that happened. And so that's just another example of working within the institution. But I also remember we were part of demonstrations on campus of like Mecha. They did a lot of the organizing the actions and the demonstrations on campus and being a part of that. Also, I was one of the student of color interns at the admissions office. And so also working with that office to figure out how do we strengthen our programming so that we're not falsifying this story when students come as accepted students, but being real about it and presenting it as this is an option and I'm not going to sell it to you, but this is a reality of what's happening here. And that you could be a part of these changes, you could be a part of, and that it wasn't all negative. Like my entire experience wasn't a terrible thing. But figuring out how is it from all these different spaces that we're always communicating with students of color, low-income students, first-generation students, how do we actually take care of them? And how do we hold the institution accountable for bringing them here so that I don't hear these conversations where students are spending 3-4 years saying that they just wanted to get out. So that was how I did that. And also just like interpersonal conversations, people in the hallways, people in classes, that kind of thing. That was my process.
Okay, we're gonna open it up for questions now. If anybody has questions for our panelists, we will come around with a mic and let you ask.
How did each of you feel your activism was being used as a way to increase your safety on campus or your voice on campus or what you felt was like, you know, because I've heard things about you saying, you know, you weren't being heard, but also you might necessarily were being safe. So there may be some of these issues that are happening with some students today on campus. What would you say about using your activism to increase your safety or your feeling of being a well-being on campus?
Well, I never felt my safety compromised. Safety in terms of my personal safety. I will say this, and maybe it's because God has a very wicked sense of humor. I am now a university administrator. And when I think about whether or not the activism resulted in something that makes me feel as though it was all worth our effort. I look back and I see 46 years of Africana studies, starting out as Black Studies and now Africana Studies, and that is an achievement. It meant the college paid attention. I hear from Mr. Chanette that we now have tenure track African American faculty. I hear and look around and see that we have many more students of color, African-American students, than we had before. So there are results, there are outcomes that make me feel as though what we had to say, our voices were heard up to a point. The nice thing about becoming a part of and trying to stay connected to AAAVC is that, you know, I'm convinced we need to stay here because the work's not done. Every generation has to have placed in their hand the baton that they then have to pick up and carry forward, that the social justice journey is never finished. So it may not be about my physical safety, but it is about have our voices been heard. And I think to some extent, to give the college some credit, there is some listening and some action taking place. Is it complete? No. Is there not a lot more that needs to be done? Yes. And it's not going to happen just snap, crackle, pop. We have to have our hands on the throttle the whole time.
Yeah. I want to add a little bit to that. You may remember that one of the lesser quoted portions of Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech was something like this. If the nation thought that we came down here and had a chance to blow off steam and now we'll be going back home and we'll be satisfied, nation will be in for a rude awakening if it returns to business as usual. Mm-hmm. What we did at our graduation was less a matter of trying to protect ourselves physically from attack. It wasn't really as much a matter of creating safety for ourselves as much as it was an effort to reaffirm who we were and who we were not. We were making statements following on the promises that had been made by the administration to say that we were not satisfied with the Eurocentric curriculum. We wanted to have expansion of our identity and our recognition as descendants of African people. There were still efforts to have us conform to some of the practices of privilege that the college had been most accustomed to. And we were saying, the job is not finished. We are who we are. We're going to be who we are. So our efforts were not really a matter of trying to protect our physical safety as much as it was to reaffirm our commitment to the road forward.
Thank you.
Right, and speaking of the road forward, I forgot to mention earlier that when we did put out our list of demands, we had a conservative group of, they call themselves conservative students, a conservative society. They sort of tried to mock our demands by putting out, this list of all of the protest leaders where they was trying to make fun of us, and that was less important. But what was important was how they signed it. Of course, they weren't brave enough to assign their own names, but they signed it as the future trustees of Vassar College, which, they were trying to clearly make a point, and a point taken. And one of the ways that we decided to respond, and this was the first year of my class, 1990, where we started wearing the kente cloth, which is a tradition that continues until this day, but that was our response. You may think that the future and or dominance that in the way or your worldview is something that would be permanent, but we wanted to make a statement of our own that that we challenge you here, we will challenge you in the boardrooms and the classrooms and everywhere else. And so the smugness of signing that document the way they did, that didn't sit well with us, and I think we responded appropriately.
As the guardian of time, we have two questions, and I would ask that you keep your remarks short so that we can get full answers to both.
My name is Pat Neely, and I'm from the class of 75. And I happened to have lunch this afternoon with a freshman who was a classmate of my daughter's here, and I was telling her about the morning session and the wonderful interview with Dr. Christmas. I said, so how are things here? And she said, the students here are really heavily polarized. And she says, I can't speak on behalf of my black friends, but I know they're hurting. And she then said, I'm part of the LGBT community, and we are hurting. and no one wants to hurt anyone else. If she said, it would be really wonderful if people from your generation could talk to us about this. Mm. So I'm wondering, this has been a wonderful panel discussion, but how many current students are here? And have you been able to mentor those? And have you been able to reach out not only to the Black community at the school, but the other marginal people who feel that they're marginalized as well?
A short answer is that we began as a marginalized community on this campus with the organization that was created. We identify with marginalization. We have our hands outstretched to every marginalized community on this campus of students, faculty, administrators as well. We have our arms open for LGBT community.
I would say yes, that I have stayed in contact in various ways. Last year when there was an incident on campus where a few citizens of Poughkeepsie, where they had an issue with the security and the library, a lot of you know what happened, I came as to testify as an alum of my experience here to support them. Even simpler things like offering my home. I had a current student come stay with me when he was visiting New York. And just offering, being able to be present in various ways, either if it's email or saying you could come to my job if you're interested in education so you could see what it looks like to work with high school students. So in those various ways, yes.
I'm from the class of 2005, and I can say that I didn't really know about AAAVC while I was a student here. And I grew up in Minnesota in a relatively white area, but it wasn't until I got to Vassar that I started to realize that my color was important to people in terms of the way that they thought about me and what I was capable of. I found that there weren't a lot of faculty of color to support me, and that really impacted my experience here. I love Vassar. I participate a lot in alumni stuff. I'm the reunion chair for my class here. But I think, you know, to Richard's point, it would be great to have more of a direct connection or a line for the current students of color on campus to the past African American alumni, just to help us through that experience, because I'm, you know, sitting here now and thinking, man, I wish I had been able to talk to you guys while I was a student here. That would have changed my whole experience and outlook. So I understand what everyone's saying, what the current students are saying. It's a difficult thing, right? Because we're definitely the minority here. But to know that there are people who have come before us and that have experienced these things and that they're willing to offer support and help would have been a great resource to have. So I want to just thank all of the panelists for coming today. It was certainly informative and invigorating, and the work is not done for sure, and hopefully the current students that are here feel like they have somewhere to go. So thank you guys. Yeah.